The choices we make and the lines we decide to walk between determines the type of life we lead. It's not always clear which forks in the road we should take, and oftentimes it's not even apparent where it splits. But there are few constants one can find if one looks hard enough. Success is usually found in following the things you love. No one became great at anything without giving up everything. And passion is fleeting. Determination is what takes you to the next level. So as we follow the things we love, we understand it's hard work and the willingness to forge through that determines the outcome of what we set out to do. So when we left you last time, Jesse and JP were headed home early due to a run-in with a rock in the Forerunner. We saw how in 12 months nature repairs a forest devastated by wildfires, found ourselves hours down an unmaintained forestry road, and our options for finding a way out were not looking promising.
So this road that we've came in on that was closed last year, we're probably an hour into it, and it was just some gnarly, gnarly terrain. And as we were driving, we noticed that a lot of the roads under us had these big dead trees growing on the actual road. And so we're at a place now where it's so far to reroute, but it looks like we're either going to have to do some maneuvering or we're going to have to reroute. And if we had to reroute, that would suck. So it'll work itself out, and we'll figure it out. So, yeah.
Hey, let's pop up the drone real quick and fly it out a ways and kind of look and see what the road kind of looks like.
10 hours. I hear a truck.
You guys hear that truck?
Yep.
Is he coming this way?
Good, let him push the brush down.
Well, we cut all those branches down. Maybe it goes through over there.
I don't think he's coming through here.
I think he's below us.
I see his dust over here.
Yeah. He's like right down there, dude. I heard a truck, though.
Or maybe it was the wind going through the trees.
Yeah, that's true. Delusional thoughts are setting in.
We think we're hearing stuff. It's water.
Yeah,
that's a mirage.
Yeah, that looks like it.
I'm smelling gasoline big time, you guys.
Me too.
Oh,
I am.
We're smelling some fuel. I think we might have.
Chris melted earlier on this rig, too.
Popped a little fuel lighter, and we're going to check it out.
I can't see anything, but I can smell just a hint of gas.
Get the rain, or get you up there on it, and then tell us.
I mean, the only way to see is see if there's a way to get up there over there.
We need to go back to the turn.
So after about 10-15 minutes of droning and looking on the maps, we realized that these roads, unless we wanted to cut down a bunch of trees and stuff, don't go through. So what we're doing now is we're going to turn around, and there's one possible alternative route that'll prevent us from having to backtrack all the way to where we turn on this road. And again, it was some, it's been some gnarly trail, really gnarly.
It'd be easier to side hill right there.
But it's our first hiccup, really, other than JP and the rock in 5 days. It's our first big reroute, so thankful for that. We're pretty familiar with this territory, but again, this was a new trail that we decided to blaze through because it was closed off last year due to the fires. So,
it was a long way back to where we had started from, and it seemed today the highway was calling our name. So we took in the terrain around us as we made the best of the situation at hand. We consider ourselves lucky to have the opportunity to face these types of challenges on our journey. Much like the trail we had just found ourselves on, the two-year path leading up to this expedition had its ups and downs, but in the end, not one of us could say we took this trip for granted. We worked for every mile we gained, and as we would soon find out, the road ahead would be no different than the one sliding out of sight as they passed through our rearview mirror.
So we had to reroute. We're about 3.5 miles from where we had to reroute. It's just slow going. Steep edges, just big old cliffs. It's part of it though, it's part of the game, rerouting, and it's kind of a defeater at times when you have to reroute because you go in some early trail and whoa, that was a stick. But anyway, it is what it is, and we're back on course. This road right here is going to lead us to where we want to go. So
we just came into Sumter, and they're kind of known for this huge dredge that they have here. Until you see it, it doesn't do justice. And I didn't really even know what a dredge was. I knew it tried to get gold, but I had no idea how it worked. And just to see the massive size of this thing, I mean, this thing is the size of like a big office building. I mean, it's got to be 8,000 square feet, two stories. Basically, the way it works is it's on a big pond, and it digs its own pond. So in the front, it has these buckets that dig water like this, and in the rear it spits out dirt, the dirt that it's taken up, and it spits it out the back and it fills in the pond, and it basically moves the pond along the earth while it processes all this dirt for gold. And the machinery inside is just, I mean, everything's super oversized. It reminds me of a shipyard kind of. I mean, all the I-beams are oversized, the chain links are huge, the gears, the motors. There's a huge turbine in here that they, when the water would shoot through, they'd process that and they'd turn a, you know, a shaft. And then so basically we'd scoop up the dirt, dump it in this big thing right here. The water would come down this chute. This thing would basically tumble and process out all the gold, and then it would fall into the sluice boxes, and then I'm sure they would have to process it, you know, by hand when it gets in the smaller sluice boxes, and it just shoots all that dirt out the back, and then when they take that boom and just dump piles of dirt.
Yeah.
I mean, the crazy thing is how destructive it is, though. I mean, you just got these mile-long pallets of just freaking piles of rock.
Yeah.
Man, this is mind-blowing.
Pretty crazy to think of what humans have built just in the past and all the, how far we've come. This thing is amazing. Just how it operates and how it works. Yeah, pretty mind-blowing. Like Jason said, it makes you feel very small.
We left Sumter, Oregon with a new respect for the ingenuity of the mid-1930s. This feat of human engineering ran its 72 massive one-ton buckets for nearly 20 years and dug up over $4 million in gold. The extent we'll go to chase the opportunity for prosperity always amazes me, and none more than this vehicle of brawn and steel. We slid from the grasp of this awe-inspiring giant and headed back to the forest trails of eastern Oregon.
Second time I've been stuck at the same exact place. I got further than last time though, by about 3 feet. So we can get out of here. And I made it over! Yay! Accomplishment! I had help from Warren! You're my best friend, Warren. I was close. Next time I come through here, I'll get over it. So third's a charm for me.
There's a funny thing about being prepared for something you've never done. You're planning for situations you can't possibly predict. Sometimes you have the right weapon in your arsenal for the opponent you face. Other times the unexpected wins the battle and you're left to your own ingenuity to overcome your adversary. But that's the thing about adventure. It's elusive, and many can go a lifetime without ever experiencing the reward from risking it all for the chance to experience life beyond the boundaries of regular life. We set aside our jobs, our friends, our families, and did it all to chase the fleeting moments when planning for the future meets the unforeseen circumstance and an opportunity to put your abilities and your knowledge to the test. Lost our power steering, and there's power steering fluid all over the bottom of the engine.
So we're good, man. We're trying to give it a hard time.
We wind our way through life's obstacles. Every challenge we overcome makes us stronger, wiser, and more equipped to tackle what lay ahead. Our journey would provide us with more than we could expect in more ways than we could count. But no matter what situation we found ourselves in, the experience faced were always better spent with those who are inspired by our common passion. So we forged ahead in our expedition, bound by adventure and ready for our shot at history.
Americans are known for over-pronunciating their speech. I had a guy come in before when I lived in Australia for a while, and he said, "Do you guys have any hamburgers? Or I'd like a Coke or a Pepsi." And he just kind of like over-enunciated all of his speech. And so I could tell he was American. But there's nothing wrong with that. It's just our accent. That's how we
talk. Like, sounds like Minnesota.
Right? I know. Minnesota. Minnesota, eh? Don't you know? Don't you know?
How's that stream?
For the lines that go from your basket to your bumper.
Oh, that was
good. We can do it.
What did you do?
You take a snapshot too.
Hey. No peeking.